What we are going to discuss today is a concept that we come across very frequently in our day-to-day practice, that is denial. Okay, we know that patient and family-centered care is the hallmark of high-quality palliative care. Now, denial will interfere with the ability to provide this type of care. It will impede the effective communication that is many times very essential for good palliative care outcomes. Hence, being able to identify and diffuse this denial becomes very important in our day-to-day practice. So today, when we discuss about denial, what we will be covering in the next hour or so is the different connotations of denial that is we see in palliative care. And we try to understand what is the clinical impact of this denial in our day-to-day practice and understand how we can address it. Coming to denial, it is a complex concept actually and has multiple definitions. When we talk about denial in a psychiatric perspective, it depicts a lack of insight, as we call it, and it is normally seen in patients with substance use disorders. And sometimes when certain set of psychiatric patients lose touch with reality, then we call it as psychotic denial, what is normally seen in schizophrenia, etc. From the neurological perspective, this denial, what we see, reflects a clinical sign of neurological damage. I'm sure most of us have heard of anosognosia, where there is a lack of awareness of an illness or a disability. But we are not going to discuss this type of denial today. What we will focus our discussion is on that denial that we see in patients with chronic illness or disabilities. So how do we define this denial? Before I proceed further, I would like you to put up any questions that you have in the chat box so that we can take it up a little later at the end of each session. So how do we define denial in palliative care or in patients with chronic physical illness? What happens when the diagnosis of a life-threatening illness is given, it precipitates an overwhelming anxiety in the patient. And denial is an initial response to fend off this overwhelming anxiety. And it is described as a conscious or unconscious repudiation of the external threat, that is the diagnosis, partly or wholly, in order to reduce the anxiety, fear, or the unpleasant effects that the individual feels. Now, to explain it further, let us go through the story of Ajay. Ajay is a 40-year-old married lawyer who noticed blood in his stools. He attributed it to piles and he took stool softness. And over the next week, as the bleeding worsened, he told his wife about this. Now, their friend had just been diagnosed with a colon cancer, and the wife was aware that this could be one of the symptoms. And she insisted that he immediately see a doctor. And at the doctor's, he jokingly remarked that his wife was over-concerned and paranoid about him having the disease. When the doctor examined and suggested that it could be cancer, he panicked. Overwhelmed by emotions, he declined further investigations and he joked. On the way back home, he joked to his wife, "The doctor is as paranoid as you. It is just piles." So there was a concept of, you know, he wouldn't accept the diagnosis at that point, the suggestion for further investigations at that point in time. But 2 weeks later, when the bleeding did not resolve, he agreed for further investigations and was diagnosed with malignancy and underwent the treatment without any issues. So this is one type of denial that we see in palliative care. And here, what Ajay has used is a sort of a coping strategy. For Ajay, the thought of having cancer caused overwhelming anxiety and it disturbed his psychological equilibrium. So what he tried to reduce this and handle this anxiety by escaping the painful reality. Okay. And here, the denial was a conscious process and it had a self-protective function, because 2 weeks later, he was able to come back for treatment and undergo the treatment and investigations as required. So this is the type of denial that has been explained in our grief theories and in the Elizabeth Kubler-Ross model of adaptation to grief. So this has a protective function. It is temporary and it is a dynamic process. Now let us look at another type of denial. Now Ajay, on being diagnosed with cancer, insisted that there was nothing wrong with him and accused the doctor of poor diagnostic skills and headed home, refusing any further treatment. At home, he refused to talk about it, or he became irritable whenever his wife tried to bring up the subject, and he went about his work on a business as usual attitude. A month later, when he was extremely weak because of the blood loss, he was admitted to the hospital and he expressed surprise that the hemorrhoids were not resolving, but refused to acknowledge that he had cancer or be treated for it. He insisted, "I have no problem. There is nothing wrong with me. It is just hemorrhoids." And the treating team found his denial impenetrable and were very distressed by it. Now, this is a very different type of denial than what we saw initially, isn't it? So this is what Freudian terms we call it as an unconscious primitive defense mechanism. Here Ajay tries to reduce his anxiety by totally rejecting the reality, that is the diagnosis of cancer. This type of denial is common in young children and is an immature response to stress. But when it continues or into adulthood, it becomes pathological. So this is a self-deceptive denial. It is a stable and static state, and this is something that can cause problems in our treatment and further care of the patient. What is important for us is to understand how this denial impacts patients' response to the illness. So now denial, we have two types. One is adaptive denial and the other is maladaptive denial. When denial is like the first example, where it was temporary, where he initially, it was suggested that he would be having cancer, Ajay sort of for about 2 weeks, he decided not to come for treatment. So, but after 2 weeks, when the symptoms continued and he had some control over his emotions and the anxiety, he was able to come back for treatment. So when, like in the first example, denial does not interfere with the care process or impede the person's ability to seek help, it has an adaptive and protective function. It is termed as adaptive denial. But like in the second example, when it prevents help-seeking behavior and interferes with the treatment and creates distress within the patient, for the family, and for the clinician himself, then denial is termed as maladaptive. As palliative care physicians, knowing what caused the denial and how it impacts care is extremely important, as our treatment decisions are normally based on communicating effectively with the family and the patient. So knowing this is extremely important. Coming to the spectrum model of denial was suggested by Sehan and Kissane, where they looked at adaptive denial as one end of the spectrum and maladaptive denial at the other end. And the degree of which the patient is aware of the denial decided whether this denial was potentially adaptive or maladaptive. So positive avoidance or minimization of the disease or suppression, etc., were looked to be more adaptive than denial that would delay treatment seeking behavior or rejection of the reality. So understanding this aspect is extremely important for us, so that we know when to manage denial and when to just support the patient. Finally, whether it is adaptive or maladaptive, one of the primary functions of denial is protection. denial reduces the effect or the spread of emotional flooding and protects the patient from excessive anxiety. And also, so it buys time for the patient to absorb the information or the in small doses and assimilate it and integrate it effectively. And to also, it gives them the time to develop a more flexible coping style so that they are able to handle the anxiety. It also helps to maintain a certain amount of hope and motivation initially so that the patient is able to come back and decide about treatment, diagnosis, etc. Basically, what it does is it preserves the integrity of the self and prevents the disintegration or, you know, the patient from falling apart because of the diagnosis. So basically, denial has a very protective function. So it would be a good idea to support it when it does not interfere with treatment or other aspects. So how do we find out or how does this denial manifest? What is it that you will look for in a patient who comes to you? So basically, I think the first thing that you look is when they come, has there been any delay in seeking treatment? That will give you an idea whether the patient is in denial or not. And like in the example, what we saw, a patient who rejects the diagnosis outright, a patient who rejects the diagnosis outright is in denial. Sometimes patients may not reject the diagnosis, but they minimize the symptoms and say, oh, this is nothing wrong. This is could be and attribute the symptoms to something else altogether, like what we saw in the example one, where he attributed the whole symptoms to piles rather than to entertain the possibility of cancer. So this is another way they might present himself. Or a patient who tells you that some amount of anxiety, distress, fear is normal with the diagnosis of a life-threatening illness. A patient who denies any of this affective component or the emotional component of this is likely to be exhibiting some amount of denial. Also, whenever a patient presents with poor compliance to treatment or somebody refuses treatment, these are the individuals that we need to look for denial in these type of patients. There are various types of denial has been described in the literature, and it will be difficult for me to explain each one of it. So I think in the references that has been given, these have been explained very well. Primarily, denial can be either implicit or partial, or it can be a complete denial. As I said, complete or explicit denial is when the patient verbally tells you there is nothing wrong with me, I have cancer, I don't have cancer, despite the evidence being given to him otherwise. Whereas in implicit or partial denial, he may accept the diagnosis but deny the prognosis or the symptoms that or some part of the long-term outcome might be denied. Similarly, there are different, as you can see, some patients may deny the emotional aspect of it, some may deny the prognosis, some may deny the outcome of the illness. So different types of denials are there. So what is the prevalence of denial? It varies widely based upon the type of definition that is used and the time of assessment. As we saw before, there could be denial of the diagnosis, denial of the impact this diagnosis has on the future of the patient, or they may deny the affective component of the denial. So the percentages just make it very obvious that it is a common symptom in palliative care. It is just that maybe we need to look for it more. No Indian studies, I have not been able to find many Indian studies that have assessed denial among our patients. But one study did mention that about 60% of the patients were unaware of their diagnosis. Obviously, unawareness of the diagnosis can also present as denial. Any questions so far before I move on to the next section? Arun?
Divakaran sir is asking whether adaptive denial is also known as positive denial.
Yes.
Yeah, that's all. Nothing else.
Oh, In the next section, we will just move on to what is the clinical impact of denial. So in this, we will look at what factors promote denial in patients and whether this is beneficial or actually detrimental. I would like to put the question across as, what do you think? Do you think denial is beneficial or it will cause more harm? You can put up the answers in the chat box, and Arun, you can just interrupt me in between when the answers do come in, right?
Okay.
Yeah. So, when we look at it, actually the drama of denial is actually played out between three players: the patient, the caregiver, and the clinician. A patient who does not want to hear about the diagnosis, prognosis, etc., and a caregiver who does not want to talk about it, and the clinician who does not want to see it. Traditionally, we thought only the patient is in denial, but newer research and studies have indicated that the denial could be there in the caregiver and in the clinician as well. So when we approach a patient with denial, it is important that we evaluate all three aspects of denial. Anything in the chat box, Arun?
Yeah, people are saying initially it can be beneficial, but later it can be harmful. That's what people say.
Okay, that's good. So let us look at we will come to that, whether it is beneficial or detrimental, a little later. But first, let us look at what are the factors that promote denial or cause denial in the patient, in the family, as well as in the clinician. And how do we recognize this denial? One, primarily, it is the experience of the illness in the patient that determines which way the patient will go. For example, a young patient who is just in the threshold of getting married gets diagnosed with a terminal illness. It creates a major disruption in the person's life and can precipitate overwhelming anxiety. So this young patients normally use denial as a coping mechanism. The second aspect is gender. Male patients are likely to deny the emotional repercussions of the disease much more than the female counterparts. So when we look at denial of effect, as we say, that is more common in the male patients. Also, the personality of the individual and the previous coping styles in the face of loss and threat also have a major impact on how individuals deal with the distress in their lives. Patients who have some sort of a neuropathology or an organic cause or a psychopathology are more likely to use immature coping styles like denial when faced with to deal with any stress. One of the most important aspects that we need to keep in mind is the relationship with the physician and the way in which the news is broken to the patient, like has a impact on how the patient responds to that situation. So breaking bad news and communication skills become very important here. Abruptly, if a diagnosis of a life-threatening illness is told very abruptly to the patient, the anxiety can be overwhelming and denial could be one of the way patient copes with that. So telling the right amount of information in the right manner at the right time is extremely important. The second aspect when we talk about the family is collusion and denial in the family caregivers. This can impede effective communication between patient, family, and clinician, and can contribute to denial. That is why, and lead to conflicts also. That is why the previous lectures of Dr. Chitra about conflict and Dr. Simha about collusion is extremely important. Certain ethnocultural factors also matter. For example, denial is much more common in the Asian and African population as compared to the West. From the clinician aspect, from the clinician side, the delay in prognosticating or suggesting futile interventions like subthreshold chemotherapy or not discussing end of life care, all these could be are continuing with futile interventions. All this could be due to denial from the clinician side to handle this issue. Sometimes anxiety about not being able to offer cure or lack of skills in communicating these issues. All these can contribute to propagating or increasing the denial in the patients as well as in the family. So we should be aware of the denial in the clinician side also. Coming to whether denial is beneficial or not is a little complicated to answer, because both in oncology as well as in non-oncology, lot of studies have gone either way. One of denial is known to reduce the quality of life. It is known to interfere with end-of-life care planning and increase suffering. There is also increased psychiatric morbidity in patients who use denial as a coping. And it affects the interpersonal relationship and communication between the physician, between the family, and between the patient. So in one side, denial is detrimental. On the other hand, studies have also shown that there is decreased anxiety and depression in patients who are not aware of their diagnosis. There is good adjustment, there is fewer symptom burden, and they function better. And some of the studies have showed an optimism resilience and enhanced optimism resilience and hope with improved survival. It is very difficult to determine whether it is actually beneficial or not, because different studies have looked at different definitions of denial and looked at different time frame when it was assessed, and it has always been they have not assessed longitudinally. It was assessed at one point in time. There was a recent study of death denial as an obstacle to good end-of-life care planning by Zimmerman in 2007. This clearly depicts that it can be a major obstacle when it comes to end-of-life care planning. And family denial was one of the major obstacles for home deaths. And futile interventions, death in the hospitals and in ICUs were more common when the family, clinician and patients were in denial. So finally, whether denial is detrimental or not depends upon multiple factors. When it is partial and it is used temporarily for a short period of time, it can be beneficial. But when in crisis, when immediate decisions have to be made, and when it is continuous and complete, then it is detrimental and it needs to be handled. Any more questions, Arun?
Ganpati sir has asked a question, is unawareness a kind of denial?
So that is when we talk about the approach to denial, I will discuss about this, like, you know, how it can appear as denial, actually, unawareness. So how to handle it, I will talk about when we talk about the approach to denial.
Okay, otherwise there is none. You can please proceed.
Okay. So now that we know what is denial, what is the types, common types of denial that we see, and what is the clinical implications of this, let us see how we are going to approach it in our day-to-day practice. Fundamentally, there is one thing, one goal of intervention, that is to facilitate adaptation, whether it is in the short term, medium term, or in the long term. And in adaptive denial, we want to sustain that stability of the emotions that the patient has. In maladaptive denial, we want to facilitate better coping and foster the change and improved coping. So this is the primary goals of our intervention. So for the next case study, I will ask Shreya to read out the case, please.
Yes, ma'am. Good morning, everyone. So the case for today is a 20-year-old unmarried event manager, Mr. Vinod. He was diagnosed with inoperable metastatic carcinoma stomach with gastric outlet obstruction. He is currently not eligible for any disease-modifying therapy and has been coming to the hospital for repeated admissions with complaints of postprandial vomiting, loss of appetite and weight, and progressive weakness. His personality is stubborn, and he's a fighter, and he thinks that he will defeat the cancer. He knows the diagnosis and the extent of the metastasis and denies any anxiety or fear about the disease.
Okay.
He also says that his symptoms are not, it's not the cancer, and the weakness is due to not eating. And he is angry at his family members for not providing him the right amount and the right kind of food. For the future, he plans to build a new house for his mother and get his sister, who's currently 12 years old, married. And he says that he will fight and stay alive for the next 10 to 12 years. When discussion about the disease is initiated, he says that he knows it, but that it can be controlled with treatment, and he just needs to gain weight for receiving chemotherapy. So there are two questions regarding this. How will we assess this denial, and how will we address Mr. Vinod's denial?
Carry on, Shreya. Tell me, how will you assess for denial in this patient?
So there is denial present in this patient. That is like how he is minimizing his symptoms and attributing his symptoms to other causes, like not having adequate food intake or because of his weakness, and not attributing it to the cancer. He's also he's unrealistically planning for the future, where he's saying that he'll live for the next 10 to 12 years and wants to get his sister married. And there is distress among him and the family members, because he is not satisfied with the care that they are providing him, like saying that they're not giving him the right kind of food. So probably they have been told to not give him semi-solid or solid food because of his illness, but he is not happy that they are giving him only liquid food. And that is also causing him to come for multiple rounds of hospital admissions, so which is causing distress to him as well. He's also denying that he has any fear or anxiety regarding the prognosis or the possibility that this will not be cured.
So there are there is denial on multiple levels in this patient, isn't it?
Yes.
So now let us just look at what are the different ways that the denial, what you explained. And basically the strategy for management, first is we have to learn to identify whether the denial is there or not. We need to assess and we need to address both adaptive as well as maladaptive denial. So how are you going to address this, Shreya? What will you do?
We'll first ask the patient about what he actually knows about the diagnosis and the prognosis. We'll resolve any doubts he has, and we'll see if there has been any misinformation or misinterpretation on his side of what has been conveyed to him about his illness. Before directly approaching or directly trying to break the denial, we'll look for the family support, whether he has support from his family, and whether there has been any collusion from their side, which might also be adding to the denial that the patient is currently having. We will not collude with them if at all the collusion is present.
So thank you, Shreya. That was really nice. So you have identified all the aspects of denial that was present in this patient. And you have also spoken about how we can address this denial. So there are certain markers of denial that you can see, like in this patient, as Shreya mentioned before, there was minimization of the illness and misattribution of the symptoms. When he said it is not the cancer, the weakness is due to not eating and I need to eat more. So this is a cognitive denial. It comes under the category cognitive denial of the illness. There is no denial of diagnosis here, but he has misattributed the symptoms and minimized it. There is also denial of prognosis here, isn't it? So when we see denial, we have to categorize it into where all the issues are coming from. There is also denial of the impact on the future. He has unrealistic optimism. I will fight and stay alive for 10 to 12 years. And also I need to eat more to gain more weight. There is also unrealistic expectation for care. There is dissatisfaction with care, anger at not being provided the right kind of food. And there is also non-cooperation because he was not complying with the dietary instructions that are given by the treating team. And there is also effective denial, that he is denying any anxiety or fear. So, as I said, the first step is to identify, which we have done. And measurement of denial, there are multiple structured, semi-structured and self-report measures that are available to identify denial and to measure denial actually. But the only problem is the measurement process is quite complex and these are difficult to administer, and many of them do not capture the multidimensional and dynamic nature of the denial. So it is better to go by our clinical judgment, and I have made this algorithm so that we can look at how to identify, look for markers, look at history and observe the patient behavior to find whether that denial exists or not. In observation, is the patient a little aloof and indifferent? Is he non-compliant? Is he denying pain? Is he repeatedly missing appointments? Is he refusing help and support? Okay. And you could also ask these questions about what he knows about the illness. How does he feel about it? What is his understanding? How worried or concerned is he about his disease? And what are the plans for future that he has? These will give you an idea of what he knows and what he doesn't know. If it is due to misinformation or inadequate information, you have to provide the information through, you know, and I'm sure all of us know about the how to provide adequate information, ask, tell, ask techniques, clarifying goals, normalizing the emotional reactions to it, you know, the in that manner. Sometimes the denial gets resolved when adequate information has been given. If it persists, then we also, at the same time, it is important to rule out any underlying psychiatric issues or neurological issues there and initiate appropriate referral. Once we have done that and we know that this is denial, we have to assess the level of denial. As I showed in the graph before, is it the denial of the illness? Is it the denial of the impact on the future? Is it unrealistic expectations? Is it denial of need of care? Or is that denial of the emotional component of the care? Once you have assessed the level of denial, assess whether this is adaptive or maladaptive. Look at, does denial interfere with important decisions and actions in life? Does denial perpetuate the problem? Like, for example, here, his denial is making him eat more of solid food and is perpetuating the problem of vomiting. So that does the, is that causing some physical problem? Has it been present over a long period of time? And is it starting to affect the interpersonal relationship? If the answer to this four question is yes, then it means denial is maladaptive. If the answer to this question is no, then we have an adaptive denial. Next comes on how do we go and approach this denial. So here we have identified now, we have assessed, and the next step is to address denial. The first step of any intervention that you do is to support the patient. Support and reassure without directing the patient. As we know, denial is a response to overwhelming emotions. So that is what we need to address first. So asking Vinod here, can you tell me why you feel this way? What is the source of anxiety in denial? Vinod, is it the disease or is it the outcome of the disease or is it something else? What do you think, Shreya, here? Or anybody? What is the primary source of anxiety in Vinod?
That he is not able to eat the kind of food that he wants. Right.
Okay, what else?
That whatever future plans, he wants to gain weight and wants to receive chemo in the future. Yes. So that he can go forward with his future plans.
Yes, and somebody has written here, he wants to be there for the family and the burden of responsibility, right? Yes, that is the primary anxiety provoking issue here, which is precipitating his other reactions, right? So that has to be addressed. That is where you will ask him to ventilate his problems, enlist friends and family as emotional buffers, assist for any family denial or collusion in the family so that these conversations can be opened up. Okay, so first one is to address his emotional aspect there. Here, what we have to be very clear about is we should not collude with the patient, nor should we confront at this point. If you eat like this, you are definitely going to vomit. It's something that you will never say to this patient because it will further increase the anxiety. Neither are you going to say, yes, we will give chemo if you gain weight. That is colluding and reinforcing his denial, right? So these are the things that you will not do. Focus on the emotions, provide support, enlist help from the family and friends, and assess denial and collusion and handle that in the family. That would be the first step. The second step would be providing information to him. You have looked after the emotional aspect, now look after the cognitive. Give him the information. And what is the information that you would provide? Would you tell him the prognosis right away, or are you going to do it in steps? Okay, so that is where your empathetic communication using NERS and the spikes techniques come into place. In this patient, what I would do is I would first focus on one problem that I would want to give the information about. What would that be here, Shreya, or anybody else?
We would help him to control his symptoms first so that then we can address whatever emotional problems he is facing.
Exactly. So we look at a symptom that is causing the maximum distress here, that is vomiting. So give him information about what is causing the vomiting. And the information, again, using the spikes technique in the right manner, use a lot of graphics to reinforce what you are saying, respond to the emotions that he feels at that point in time, and show him what is happening within his body that is precipitating the vomiting. And once we have handled emotions, provided the information, it is time to initiate a behavioral change. And the behavioral change that we will see here is looking at trying to eat liquid food for a short period of time. So this is where we need to negotiate with the patient and reinforce behaviors that will help in preventing the vomiting. So what we could do here is to tell him, let us give it a trial for 2 days, that you be on liquid food. Let us see how it goes. At the same time, do not promise anything or give unrealistic hope about, if you do this, the vomiting will get controlled. What we need to say is, because we also are not sure, admit it that we don't know how this is going to go, but let us give it a trial and see. If the vomiting responds, good. If the vomiting does not respond, then we will have to again talk to him further. Also, at the same time, we could tie him up with someone who has had a similar problem. Would you like to speak to someone with similar problems who can tell you how to handle this? So introducing peer support to support groups becomes important. And reinforcing behaviors. So this is how you bring about a behavioral change in the patient. And the next step would be, after we have done this, and once we have addressed the emotional components and of the patient, is then we would like to challenge the denial, or like to diffuse the denial in the patient. So here, it is very important. This is a very crucial task, and it can cause a lot of distress to the patient. So when we initiate this conversation, it is important that we be available for the patient at all times, and we have proper support systems in place, both social support as well as professional support systems in place when we initiate this discussion. A simple example is, weekend would not be a right time to initiate this discussion with the patient because it can cause a lot of distress. Here, you walk the patient through about how the story of his illness, how he has been in the last 2 weeks, 3 weeks, a month, how his disease progressively he has gotten weaker. Is there a time? Ask him questions like, is there a time when you feel that the weakness may not improve? then how do you explain the changes despite having chemotherapy that, you know, the disease has not improved? How do you feel about it? So that way you walk him through this and look for inconsistencies in the story. Take those inconsistencies and challenge his denial at that point in time, making sure that the support systems are in place. This is extremely important stage. And as the generally when we do this over a period of time, patients are able to understand and attain a lot of clarity in what is happening to them. In one more thing that beyond this, what you can do is you need to follow and monitor denial. We may not be successful at all times in handling the denial. At that point, it is important to allow, give the patient time to reflect on the questions that you have asked them, and to using statements like, I understand this is how you feel currently. Maybe we can meet again and discuss this again at a later time when the patient is ready to come for discussions again. And the policy of non-abandonment, even if there is consistent denial in the patient, is extremely important. At each point, reassuring and reinforcing the your point without colluding or with the patient is extremely important. So these are the simple steps that you can use to manage denial. So to end this, actually, what I would like to say is it's very commonly, denial is a common concept that we encounter in our day-to-day clinical practice. It is a complex concept and there are many definitions, descriptions, and dimensions to it. Identifying it is extremely important, and it is a dynamic process changing with the disease trajectory. It can come and go. So we should incorporate looking for denial in the routine clinical assessment. It is protective. When it is protective, we should not prematurely dash hopes, and it is very vital to the patient well-being. The approach to denial is complex and multidimensional and needs very careful consideration. And an insightful clinical response will help the patient achieve a balance between the fear and adaptation, and it is a best approach. We should not hurry to, you know, break the denial or handle it, but understand what the patient is going through and help them in their journey of adaptation. So generally, if we just look at ourselves and how often that we use denial when we come across unpleasant realities, it will help us understand our patients who are going through such a life-altering experience better. It can be very normative even in our day-to-day life. So if we understand that, we will not be in a hurry to break the denial, as we say. It is not about breaking it, but it is about diffusing and helping the patient to adapt to the life journey. Thank you. These are the references are there. There are about 12 references. I think all you want to know about denial is there in this.
Thank you, Seema. Such a wonderful presentation. I think what a way of explaining denial. Arun, before we take the question answer, I think Dr. Santosh, I can see Dr. Santosh is there in the audience. Dr. Santosh, you want to add something in the denial? Or anyone?
Good morning. I think it was very comprehensive, and all the aspects have been covered very, very beautifully. All I would like to say is I would just like to reinforce and reiterate what Seema mentioned, is that in our patients, most of the time the denial is it is a very protective thing, and it does not interfere with treatment. So we need to, many times clinicians get very, very upset when there is denial and they say, oh, denial is there. What shall we do? What shall we do? And they get very upset. So there is no need to get very worked up about it. Our patients, even if there is denial, they are very cooperative and they follow the instructions of the doctors and others. So even if they say, oh, I don't think I have got disease, if you ask them, can you come next week for, you know, we will plan radiation treatment, and they will come. So we need not get very bothered about denial, as long as patients are very cooperative and compliant with the treatment. It is only in a short proportion of cases where the denial is such that they say, why should I take treatment? Why should I come here? Why should I go for palliative care? I don't think I have advanced disease. I don't think I'm, you know, nearing death. In such situations, as Dr. Seema has mentioned, that we look for a window in the communication which would show that, you know, somewhere or the other they are, you know, they have the idea that they might be having something serious. And we pick on that and develop on that in order to deal with denial. But otherwise, I think a very well covered topic, and it's very important for one to understand the concept of denial. Thank you very much.
Seema, I have just one question. Can I ask?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, sorry, two. One is, does wishful thinking become a part of denial, number one? Number two is, in the process of assessing whether the denial is adaptive or maladaptive, as the symptom burdens worsen, you know, trying to diffuse that through cognitive measures, will it trigger further anxiety?
So that is what wishful thinking is, part of a coping style, right?
Okay.
But as long as, again, as I said, it is all seen through the lens of how much it is interfering with your treatment.
Okay.
That is why it is very difficult to categorize it. It depends upon how, like, I will give you an example with one mother that I met with. She was referred to me because she was not saying that she was in denial, not able to accept her son's prognosis. Okay. When I went to meet her, she stopped me at the door of the room and didn't allow me to enter the room. And then she spoke to me right there. So I just asked her, I needed to talk to you about his future plan and what you understand. She told me one thing, doctor, I know that he's dying.
Okay.
But if I accept it, I will fall apart and I will not be able to look after him.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Okay,
So that is wishful. So what appeared as wishful thinking to others that he would survive was her way of coping. She was waiting for her daughter to come before, you know, she could share this burden because she was the only caregiver.
Okay.
Allowed that thinking to go on. It was not denial. It was an adaptive coping mechanism.
Okay. All right.
Right?
Okay.
So there was no point in, you know, breaking it at that point in time.
Correct.
Helping her cope with the situation. So I think visual thinking also, it's very difficult to generalize it. It's a part of coping. But if that is going to interfere with what is going to happen in the future, it is preventing discussions about dying, then yes, it needs to be handled.
Okay. Thanks.
So Arun, we have 10 minutes and there are many good questions. So please go ahead with the questions one by one.
Yeah, there are many. Thank you for the presentation. There are many questions. So one question was about wishful thinking, which was already discussed. So the next question is about, from Anju, medium John, the patient may go for second, third, fourth opinion when the patient is in denial.
Hmm.
How to help without seeming to be too anxious about retaining the patient?
Yeah. So I think as far as this is where you have to have those clear-cut communication with the patient. Patient has every right to go for different opinions because it is the patient's right to be sure about what as being said. So I think just to clarify the diagnosis or prognosis, if the patient is going for opinion, it is right. But if that going to the opinion is part of his escaping from the truth and wishing that, you know, then we may have to come back and ask him and find out what is the underlying fear that he has. Find out that and address that. What is making him go from doctor to doctor? That underlying fear we have to identify and address. What we are looking at is the topmost behavior, right? Of seeking multiple opinions. But what is driving that behavior is something that we have to address. What is perpetuating that denial? Is it the family aspects? Is it the individual factors? That we have to find out and address it.
Thanks. So that was about the patient. And again, Dr. Punita Lal is asking that there is sometimes denial of immediate caregiver, which interferes. That is very true. And sometimes there are constant urge to go towards treatment. We discussed that. Then what to do with when the denial is within our colleagues?
Okay. So that becomes a little more difficult to address. I think there what Dr. Chitra told about communicating with between team members, right? How to resolve a conflict, how to communicate in a better manner and reach a collaborative way. That those steps you will have to use there.
Okay. So now there's a comment from Dr. Lulu Matthews, like adults, denial can manifest as lack of awareness. Okay. In children or adolescents, it could be vice versa. Okay. Nobody has taken time to explain their disease to an adolescent. In order to know every detail, he might say, I do not know, which could be interpreted as denial. So that's very nice. So what is your opinion on that?
Yeah, I agree with you completely, Lulu ma'am, that most of the time, lack of information or misinformation is misinterpreted as denial. That is why in that algorithm that I put in, the first step when we look at denial is to ensure that the patient has had the full information, or even an adolescent, because an adolescent is also capable of understanding what is happening. My experience has been is sometimes the parents think the children don't know, but the adolescents are much more aware of what is happening to themselves and their body. Only thing is they have not been given a chance to communicate about it. So, yes, it is very important to rule out lack of information or misinformation and clarify that before we label it as denial. So that is, I think, one very important aspect and something that we need to keep in mind, given that most of our patients' collusion is very common in India. This is something that we have to keep in mind. Like this patient, Vinod, is a real life patient of mine. One of the things that had happened with him is he actually never understood the magnitude of his problem. So when I sat visually and explained where all the metastasis was and what all was causing it, it did, shift the denial a little bit, and that stubbornness disresolved and that impenetrability did come down a little bit once adequate information was provided about what could happen. So absolutely, Lulu ma'am, I agree completely with you about that aspect, that we need to first give the information before we say that this patient is in denial.